हेलो माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक टू KCYC चैनल। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू कंटिन्यू द लेक्चर व्हिच वी हैव स्टॉप्ड लास्ट टाइम, चैप्टर 1 लॉज ऑफ मोशन पार्ट 2। द नेक्स्ट पार्ट इज यूनिफॉर्म सर्कुलर मोशन। इट इज अ मोशन परफॉर्म बाय अ पर्टिकुलर बॉडी in a circular path with constant speed. Very carefully you have to understand, constant speed should be there, then only it will be a uniform circular motion. Here in this figure you will able to see a body performing a uniform circular motion in a circular path with radius r. If you look at the different points, the body reaches over here, the velocity vector will be directly perpendicular to the radius. That means, like at any instant, if it loses the force, it will go in this direction, or over here it will go in this direction. That is, it won't be circulating this path if it is loses its force. So that means uniform circular motion is a motion performed by a body if it is in a circular motion with a constant speed. Like for example, you can consider a tip of a fan, okay, a tip of a fan with a certain speed, a fan, a ceiling fan, the tip of that fan is having a uniform circular motion. Next part is UCM. Here we are able to understand what is actually mathematically how it works on. Here we have a speed. What will be the speed of uniform circular motion can be given by circumference of the path upon time. The time taken by the body to complete one circumference, it will be the exact way to represent that. You will be able to find such example. Like for example, here we have got a giant wheel at every point, like these cabins at every point, you will be able to find there is a force this way. So if it is uniform circular, if it is in a uniform circular motion, you'll be able to find out how it works on the time taken by here to come time taken by this cabin to from here to here. Okay, that is calculated, then circumference is calculated, ultimately we'll get the velocity of a body in UCM. Now you have to also revise the previous part of this chapter in order to understand the laws of motion very carefully. If you have not revised this, kindly stop this video and go and revise the previous video and continue with this video. Before starting this part, I want everybody to take your textbook in your hand and keep it open with the laws of motion, because textbook is very much needy so that you can understand this part of the chapter. And also would like to make it clear, the laws should be by heart. Okay, you cannot write in your own words. It should be as it is in the textbook. So we are going to start with the laws of motion. Here the first law of Newton says that an object continues to remain at rest or in a state of uniform motion along a straight line unless an external unbalanced force acts on it. Very carefully, if you look at the statement, it is very much understood how it works on. An object continues to remain at rest or in state of uniform motion along a straight line unless an external unbalanced force acts on it. It is very much evident that if an object is at rest, if you push it, then only it will move. That is the external force. Unless, it will remain in the same position only. It is also valid for an object which is moving. Like for example, if you are moving an object, like for example a football is moving in a field, okay, it have to be opposed, it have to be introduced by some other force so that you have to make it into rest until it will move on. Okay, yes, of course there will be lot of other components coming into picture when with respect to the example of football. So learn this law. Okay, actually this is called as law of inertia. Inertia is actually a tendency to do nothing or to remain unchanged. Okay, if it is at a constant state, it is stable, then it will remain stable. It is moving, then it will move. Okay, So if it is at rest, if an object is at rest, it will remain at rest. If an object is moving, it will be at a moving place only, okay, or moving condition only. Here I'll just give a small example. You can compare a small sofa and a larger sofa. For a small sofa, you can easily push it and move it here and there. But for larger sofa, the tendency to remain unchanged is much more higher. That means the inertia for this larger sofa is much more higher over here. So similar example is there over here. There is a glass, there is a cardboard, there is a coin. When a cardboard is pulled, the coin falls into the glass. This is because the inertia of the coin maintains its state at rest. Like example, like over here, the coin just fall. It won't come with respect to this. As you pull this cardboard or paper, it won't come with this paper. This is the inertia of that coin, which tends that coin to remain at that position. Of course, it will fall. That is due to gravity, nothing else. Okay, that is inertia. You have to understand this law very carefully. You have to by heart it. The next law is very important. The rate of change of momentum is proportional to the applied force, and the change of momentum occurs in the direction of the force. Here, what is momentum? Momentum is given by P equal to M into V, where M will be mass and V will be the velocity. The velocity into mass will get momentum. The rate of change of momentum is proportional to the applied force in the direction of. I think this is actually a bit confusing for you people, but it is a most fascinating law. Okay, so the rate of change of momentum is proportional to applied force, and the change of momentum occurs in the direction of the force. So in order to make it simplify, I want you people to understand this diagram. Here we have talked about two things, that is momentum, velocity and mass. Three things actually. Here we will be able to see the slope. The slope is almost identical, but here we have got a bicycle and here we have got a truck. So if it is the same slope, the velocity should remain same. But the momentum will change because the mass of the cycle is much more less with respect to mass of this truck. So for example, if the truck is going through the slope, it will have a higher momentum because mass is very much high. When the cycle goes in here, it will have a less momentum since its mass is very much low. So either the mass should be increased in order to obtain a higher momentum, or velocity should be increased so that in order to obtain higher momentum. Momentum is generally we call it as an impact. Okay, so this state that the rate of change of momentum is proportional. How the rate of change of momentum changes? It is proportional to the applied force, and change of momentum occurs in the direction of the force. Wherever there is direction of force, there only the change of momentum will take place. Now, this part is there in your textbook. What is actually change in momentum? Wonderfully explained over here. Suppose an object has mass m and initial velocity v. Remember, we have learned about initial velocity and final velocity in the previous class. So when a force f is applied in a direction to its velocity with time, its velocity become v, where u will be initial velocity and v will be final velocity. The initial momentum can be given back out into the formula. Momentum is equal to mass into velocity, p equal to mv. Here the momentum, the initial momentum can be given by mass into initial velocity, and the final momentum can be given by, after certain time, can be given by mass into final velocity. So the rate of change in momentum can be given by change in momentum upon time. So what is change in momentum? Change in momentum is nothing but final momentum minus initial momentum. Rate of change in momentum is given by final momentum minus initial momentum. Ultimately we get mathematically v minus u. Remember, what is v minus u? Initial velocity and final velocity. So final velocity minus initial velocity is nothing but acceleration. Remember the previous class, we have already learned about it. So mass into acceleration, ultimately you will get ma. So this entire part is acceleration, the entire part. This is final velocity minus initial velocity upon t, will get this. Clear with that? According to Newton's second law, the rate of change of momentum is proportional to applied force. That is, ma is applied, is directly proportional to f. Force into mass into acceleration is applied to force. That is nothing but constant of proportionality, which is having value a. So ultimately this goes on. That's why you get f equal to m into a. That is, we call as force is equal to mass into acceleration. This is the actual formula for second law, Newton's second law. force equal to mass into acceleration. The third law is very much easy to every action force has an equal and opposite reaction force. So every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. So similar example I can give you for this respect to this. Here got a rocket over here with having a propulsion. Here got a balloon over here with having this condition. So when the air throws from this side, air throws in this direction, the balloon will move in this. This is an action, this is a reaction. So here in the same way, when the gas, hot gas comes out from the nozzle, the rocket will move forward. That is action, this is a reaction. So every action force has equal and opposite reaction force, which acts simultaneously. They are equal, but definitely they are opposite in direction. Okay. The next part we are discussing here is about conservation of linear momentum. What is conservation of linear momentum? It is said that the magnitude of total final momentum will be equal to magnitude of total initial momentum. And here in this part, we are mathematically proving it. So in order to mathematically prove it, we have to imagine certain things. So the imagination will be like this. For example, suppose an object A has mass m1 and initial velocity u1, and object B has mass m2 and initial velocity u2. According to the formula of momentum, the initial momentum A will be m1 u1 and that of B will be m2 u2. That is, momentum is given by mass into velocity. Suppose two objects collide. Look at the figure over here. Suppose two objects collide with each other. At that moment, the force due to A to B will be F1. Carefully, the force on A due to B will be F1. The force on A due to B will be F1. The force will cause acceleration in A. So this will be causing an acceleration in A. There will be an acceleration happening over here, and velocity will become V1. Momentum after collision will be M1 into V1, where this is the final velocity. According to Newton's law of motion, third law of motion, there will be an equal and opposite force exerted on B, but in opposite direction, of course. Momentum of B after collision will be definitely M2 V2, where V2 will be the final velocity of body B. Its F2 is force that acts on object B. Ultimately, F2 will be minus of this F1, because even the force are equal, but the direction is opposite. So that's why the minus sign came in. So we can use the formula. F2 can be given by M2 A2. This is from this formula we can derive this. And A2 is nothing but change in velocity with respect to time. Ultimately, we are having this substitution. Then mathematically, this will cut. This will get cancelled. We are going to multiply this M2 into this bracket and M1 into this bracket. We will get this. Rearranging it. So this is the magnitude of final momentum, where M2 V2 plus M1 V1 is equal to M1 U1 plus M2 U2. So total magnitude of final momentum will be equal to total magnitude of initial momentum. This derivation is very much important exam point of view, very much important. I want everybody to just write it down properly as it is in this video, so that you can learn it and you have to revise it one more time. Followed by the linear conservation of momentum, if no external force acting on two objects, suppose there is no external force acting on, this is a corollary for this derivation, then there is total initial momentum is equal to total final momentum. When no external force acts in between two objects, their total momentum remains constant and does not change. When two objects collide, the total momentum before collision is equal to total momentum after collision. So momentum will remain same whether it is collided before or after, it will remain same. That's what the conservation of linear momentum is all about. So this is a condition, like for example, this conservation of linear moment, to say that, for example, you know, to understand the principle, you have to consider just fire a bullet from a gun. When a bullet have mass M1 is fired from a gun of mass 2, M2, that is, bullet has mass M1 and the gun has mass M2, its velocity become M1 and the momentum will become M1V1. Velocity become V1, sorry, it momentum will become M1V1. Before firing the bullet, both the gun and the bullet are at rest, and hence the total initial momentum is zero. According to the law which is over there, the total final momentum has to be zero. Thus, the forward moving bullet causes the gun move backward. That will be we call it as recoiling of gun. We call it a recoil. When you click the trigger, you must have seen in movies and all, when you just click the push the trigger, you will get a backward jerk. That is a recoil. That is due to conservation of linear momentum is happening over here. I hope you understand this part. With this, we are completing our chapter, Laws of Linear Momentum. Thank you so much.